Oh my! Game of Thrones is traveling deeper into fan fiction, heading into romance novel territory, complete with male protagonists who's shirtless. It was so hilarious, and I also loved it. Okay, so yeah, a dragon got turned, but who couldn't see that coming from a mile away? Even with the spoilers that leaked in advance, it seemed like an obvious next step. Obvious to everyone who I guess was only watching the show, because everybody in the show, for some reason, couldn't figure that out. From Danny, because I was like, we've all been calling you Danny for this whole show. Sorry, Daenerys. But also, nobody in the Game of Thrones Suicide Squad figured out. They burned that body. They were like, oh, we can't let this guy get turned. And they saw an undead polar bear. I don't know why they didn't. Maybe nobody wanted to draw the natural conclusion. They're like, maybe if we don't think about it, it won't happen. But it did. All right. So anyway, top six moments of the episode. The first is the fires of love. I'm so sorry for all of you who don't want to see it happen. But Jon Snow and Danny are totally getting together. They're like, this is why this incest is okay. But the Jaime and Cersei Lannister incest is not, right? Like, the show is working so hard to make it, like, wholesome incest or give it a free pass. And I think, actually, they're doing a pretty darn good job. So they're like, Ser Jorah is like, give this sword to your child, Jon Snow. And he's like, oh, yeah, I guess I should have kids. And you can tell he was, like, thinking of Dany at that moment. Then also, Tyrion's like, who's your successor, Danny? And she's like, you know I can't have kids. And we're all like, ooh. I mean, and last week's, my recap of last week's episode, so many of you, or maybe the one before, but a lot of you were like, oh, Danny can't have kids, Grace. But then some of you were like, well, she can, but only with another Targaryen. And we all know who another Targaryen is, right? So Danny's like, Jon's like, I'll replace the child you lost. That's hilarious. Writes itself. And so they have to continue the Targaryen bloodline, or else who's going to resurrect dragons in the future and wield that sword? You can't give that sword to a dragon. So it's an incest-free pass. I also enjoyed the hilarity of her little comment saying that Jon Snow's too small for her and then realizing that she was talking to Tyrion. That was hilarious. But that end scene was everything. They had the glistening chest with ultra cool stab wounds, and the camera like slowly panned down, and I was like, this is so funny. And then I'm sure Danny was like, I know how to warm him up. It's hilarious. It's like, it's just, you're watching it like, I'm watching it like Tormund watches Brienne, and we'll talk about that. But then, when he came to and Danny was sitting there, you just know that Jon Snow was like, is my shirt off? And he's like, it is! Thanks for the fast forward, Game of Thrones Cupid. Hilarious stuff. So funny. I mean, he just came out of a frozen lake. He should be so cold. But pull the fur blanket up around his neck after she leaves. Okay, so speaking of love, who else thought that Tormund's fantasy about happily ever after with Brienne was like the sweetest thing you ever heard? I was like, Brienne doesn't like you now. Let's just tell her about this. But oh no! Sansa has sent her to King's Landing, Littlefinger style, and also because of manipulation by Littlefinger, to get her out of the way, because Sansa has to deal with Arya. I did not see that coming. I thought that maybe Sansa was going to use Brienne against Arya, but no, she's like, just go and be my emissary. And I'm like, I can't think of a worse person to be an emissary. All right, although I am excited for a Brienne and Jaime reunion. But I'm rooting for Tormund. I think he's fabulous. But you know what else I realized while watching this episode? That Tormund and Bronn are the exact same character. They both know like a nobleman, and they teach him about the real world, you know, and fighting dirty on the streets and give him real advice. It's hilarious. And I like both those characters quite a bit, actually. So I guess I'm a Tormund and Bronn type of gal. And then, also at the end, when Tormund almost died, I got real upset. I was like, this is going to get really unfun really fast. Basically, I felt how many of you felt when a dragon got shot in episode 4. And I wonder if you guys are... this dragon got resurrected. He was a bleeder, right? Everywhere. Let's talk about that. So, dragon got turned. Will it breathe fire or ice? I'm hoping for ice, quite frankly. And if its wings rot, how will it be able to fly? like, that polar bear could still walk, but, you know, you need the skin on the wings to stay aloft, so that could be a walking dragon real fast. We'll see. I find these things interesting, and I wonder if the show will actually try and figure out the science. They're like, it's a fantasy show, leave us alone. Do you want an ice-breathing dragon or not? And then also, I thought, for a moment, I thought that it was the snow or iced undead dragon was going to protect an undead Jon Snow after he fell into the water, also like Jaime Lannister, interestingly enough. I thought that's what was going to happen. But it was ridiculous how lucky Jon Snow was that he beat all those undead under the water, crawled out wearing all that heavy fur, and then Uncle Benji showed up. I was like, oh, you guys are even pushing my, you know, willingness to let things go for the characters that I love. I'm starting to come around with Jon Snow, largely because I think he and Danny are such a great couple. They actually kind of look a little bit alike, too, more so than Jaime and Cersei, which really adds to the feeling of incest. But it's okay, we're giving them a free pass. And I thought also it was hilarious when Jon Snow rode up from, you know, to the Night Watch, to the Wall. And I'm sure Ser Jorah was like, damn it, are you kidding me? We'll talk about Ser Jorah momentarily. But next I want to talk about Arya, who should, like, totally dial it way down. I'm like, what the hell, Arya? Does anyone still like Arya? I mean, I think she has just gone full psycho. I also think someone, you know, this is the problem with dropping out of assassin school, as I pointed out last week. You got to pick your battles, and allies are important. And I mean, like, I think she's just alienating everyone. And I'm also really sad to see the intense jealousy that that she's clearly had of Sansa since they were kids. And it's also sad that it's so effective to pit women against each other. I was like, come on, don't be a cliche, ladies. But they totally are. And this whole thing is making both of them very unlikable. Arya, again, because she's a psycho. And also, with those literal faces, I was like, I thought it was magic. I didn't know you had a bag of faces. This goes from, like, cool and mystical to just Buffalo Bill. You're just really, you're a psychopath. I think, just like, I think they're paving the way for it to be okay for Danny and Jon Snow to be together. I think they're like, Arya's gonna go soon, and we don't want anyone to feel bad about it. And also, as far as Sansa goes, I've been really a big, strong supporter of Sansa, but get a backbone already. I'm so tired of her, like, running to Littlefinger for help, you know, whining, letting Arya... I mean, I just... When Arya's like, let's play this game, I'd be like, no, I'm not playing your stupid game. It's just so ridiculous. It's just, Sansa just keeps... Every time I think she takes a step forward, she takes two steps back. All right, next... Game of Thrones Suicide Squad. They have amazing social skills. Like, they had the most heart-to-heart chats on that walk, having, for the most part, just met each other. It was like The Long Walk to Battle, presented by the Hallmark Channel. I also thought the show totally cheated. Where did all those other additional wildlings come from that went on went on this pilgrimage, right? Like, every time one of them was fed to the undead, I was like, wait a minute, who the hell are you? Where'd you come from? And several times, I thought it was the same wildling, actually. I was like, is that the same guy with the black beard and mustache? I thought he just died a minute ago. They're like, we took triplets with us. Whatever. And speaking of cheating, I don't know why nobody was like, you guys have fire swords? Nobody told me we could bring fire swords and that they were even available. And nobody took that other guy's fire sword when he died. And I told you, the fire guys would be the first to go. They only killed one of them. But I thought it was interesting. It reminded me a lot of the Revenant bear attack. So it looks like somebody did their research, because apparently that's how bears attack and kill. I think that one more person on this Game of Thrones Suicide Squad should have died. I think that to only have one die just wasn't enough, quite frankly. I'm not sure who it should have been. I mean, it could have been the other fire dude, but I feel like, we all expected both of them to die. I would have taken Ser Jorah. Let him go out a hero instead of the slow death that he's going to suffer watching Danny and Jon Snow get together. It's going to be the death of a thousand love stares. Okay, kisses that are not involving him. It's going to be horrible. All right, then finally, I've come to agree with many of you that Tyrion is a bad hand. I thought that the advice about seeing things from the enemy's perspective was excellent. But then it just became crystal clear to me, and I think it's going to become clear to Dany very soon. And I think she already has an inkling, because she was like, she just basically just ignores all of his advice most of the time. But I just don't think that he's aggressive enough. I just don't think he cares enough about or respects the Game of Thrones. I mean, if pressed, the things he's being asked to help attain have no real value in his eyes. Like, if she doesn't get the throne, it'll be like, we tried. Let's go find some wine and some hookers. It's all going to be awesome anyway. And he's like, it's like having a college professor as a military strategist. It's just not for him. You're a great guy, Tyrion. You're a lot of fun. But this just isn't the right career path for you. So the season finale is next week. It looks a little weak, but we'll see. Usually the season finale is never as good as the second to last episode. But this was the second to last episode, and I think this was good, but there could be more. So hopefully, because there's a different episode count this season, it won't follow the same pattern. I'm excited to see Cersei's reaction to meeting a member of the undead. And I think, by the way, with the undead, that's a very important clue I think they've laid there, or planted, with that they fall. Everyone who a White Walker turned falls when that White Walker is killed. And that perhaps the Night King, if he's killed, everybody will die. I thought that was very, I was like, you know, they don't say that stuff for a reason, you know, for nothing. But also, I really do feel that Cersei's going to go Lady Stoneheart. Lady Stoneheart's a huge part of the mythology. They never did it with Catelyn Stark. It's just sitting there. And I think that Cersei also is becoming increasingly unlikable because of the way she's treating Jaime. And I think it's only going to get worse for the two of them. And I think, again, they're setting it up so she can go full White Walker. And it's going to be amazing. All right. So write your own thoughts down below. Thank you for going over this episode with me, and you can check out some more videos right now.